Everyone to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee's 28th meeting of 2020. We have apologies from Mark Ruskell and from Finlay Carson, and John Scott joins us as a substitute for Finlay Carson this morning. Our first item today is to decide whether to take item 3, consideration of evidence heard in private. I will look to my colleagues to see if they agree with that. And see agreement. And our next item today is consideration of a notification from the Scottish Government in relation to consent to a UK statutory instrument, and that instrument is the Ozone Depleting Substances and Fluorinated Greenhouse Gases Amendment, EU Exit Regulations 2020. And members will recall that there is an agreed protocol between the Scottish Government and the Parliament in relation to instruments being made by the UK Government under powers in the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018. And which relate to proposals within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. The Scottish Government and the Parliament have agreed on a UK-wide approach to statutory instruments, for example, to avoid duplication of effort or where only technical or minor amendments are required. So this notification, minor and technical, but it did raise some issues for the committee. And I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary on the 13th of October 2020, and a copy of that letter is included in the public papers for the meeting. Our general concerns were around the common frameworks and the status of them before we look at this SI, and a lot of our questions will be around that theme this morning. So I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and our officials to the meeting today. Her officials are Ross Loveridge, the Head of Heat Demand and Carbon Markets Unit, Alice Mitchell, the Head of Carbon Markets, and Ewan Page, UK Frameworks Policy Manager, Constitution and UK Relations Division for the Scottish Government. Good morning to you all. So we'll go through the issues, and there may be others that occur to members. I'll just remind members if they want to just sort of signal to me if they want to come in on anything by using the chat room function. I'll just bring up my papers. So Cabinet Secretary, as I said in my introduction there, the detail of the SI was one thing, but the main concern we had was around our ability to scrutinise what's happening with the common frameworks. And I wanted to ask you something around that, because obviously not having detail of the common frameworks in front of us raised some questions around not just this SI, but potentially others that come before us in this sphere. So I wanted to ask you if the Scottish Government's consulting the Parliament on the framework of this particular framework as a whole through this notification, and ask you roundabout about that, how the negotiation around the common frameworks like this one is going.
Well, I can really only speak to the common frameworks that arise out of my own portfolio issues, and I suppose the answer is that they have been going much more slowly than any one of us would have wished. In terms of consulting the Parliament on both this framework and frameworks on a whole, the process of our consultation is mainly through the committee, for obvious reasons. Evidence has already been provided to the committee by an official level briefing on 9th of June, and I think that there would have been a lot of technical discussion about this. And of course, in the response that we have just sent to you, which sets out the approach to the whole development, scrutiny and implementation of common frameworks. The fact is that the delivery plan, the revised Common Frameworks delivery plan, isn't going to be available for scrutiny by any legislature until 2021, and we are trying as hard as we can to make sure that provisional arrangements will ensure that this particular framework is operational from January 21, and a summary and progress update on this particular one will be sent to legislators before the end of 2020. So this particular meeting isn't the Scottish Parliament's only opportunity to scrutinise this particular common framework. I mean, obviously, there are other frameworks that are under discussion, this notification itself really only relates to the SI that fixes deficiencies in retained EU law, which provides a legislative basis for January 2021. So there are other aspects to it as well. And I think that is one of the difficulties that arises in terms of common frameworks, because it's not just SI driven. It's that, you know, there are other aspects to it. The common framework, I suppose, that has been most discussed, we tend not to think about it as a common framework, but of course it is in reality, is the replacement for the EU ETS. And that would be the one about which there has been more discussion than perhaps any other one. And that has been under discussion now for years, not just, but we are still not at the point where we actually have a common framework on that one decided either. So they're all in a slightly different space. They're all proceeding. None of them have gotten so far as to be able to give a formal indication of a sort of outline agreement to any legislature at the moment.
Thank you. And I think you hit upon our main reason for having you in front of us today. And you said that this would not be our only opportunity to scrutinise this particular common framework. And I think that when we got the notification, that was a concern. Can I hand over to my colleague Liz Smith for some more questions around common framework that we will be looking at?
Thank you very much, convener. Just in response to the questions that were asked by the convener, could I just ask the Cabinet Secretary, is there a particular reason why this SI would be discussed through secondary legislation rather than by primary legislation?
Well, in the main, we would use secondary legislation. I mean, in the main, most governments will use secondary legislation because it tends to provide a speedier and more effective way of making the changes that are necessary. The SI programme for all of the governments at the moment is particularly heavy for that reason. Primary legislation, just by its very nature, will take considerably longer, and we don't actually require it to maintain regulations in this policy area. So, you know, there's always a decision to be made about whether or not something it needs to go through primary legislation or can be dealt with through SIs. So there is a retention of EU law already by the EU Withdrawal Act 2018. And this SI in this notification fixes technical deficiencies. So we're retaining by the EU Withdrawal Act 2018 EU law, the SI and this notification just fixing technical deficiencies that arise out of that. So it isn't a hugely, I hesitate to say it's not substantive, but it's about fixing very specific technical decisions. And this legislative approach replicates the EU regimes. It will be operable by January 21, which would not have, I don't think, been possible if we'd all gone through primary legislation with it. And it ensures the whole of the UK's continued compliance with international obligations, which is really important as well.
Yeah. So is it my understanding that your expectation is that the following SIs that relate to this common framework will also be secondary legislation?
No further legislation is actually anticipated to establish this framework for operation from January 2021. So this right. Complete that. So if there were any potential future changes that required to be made, then they would be SIs as far as I'm aware as well. But, I would have to get out the crystal ball to try and work out what it might be. And a lot depends on what it is you're actually doing at the time. But on this particular one, this finishes it.
Right. That's helpful, Cabinet Secretary. I'm asking the questions because, as you know, when it came to the Finance Committee, there were concerns raised about when it was appropriate to use primary legislation, when it was appropriate to use secondary legislation, and just trying to get a handle on whether it's to do with the timescale and obviously the huge number of complexities that you have to go through. Because I think it's absolutely vital that there is proper scrutiny in Parliament, and therefore obviously primary legislation can enhance that scrutiny in comparison with secondary legislation. So it was just to try and get a handle on that.
I think in truth, if we had tried to do all of this, and by we, I kind of mean all the administrations in the UK, if we'd all tried to do this through the process of primary legislation, we'd have been here in a decade. And obviously that was not an acceptable way to proceed. So we have had this galloping programme of SIs. All of us have had to deal with it. And I'm conscious that they are being done in an expedited fashion as well, and that is that is a challenge for every single parliament in the United Kingdom, and we are all just trying to do the best we can. And some of them were more substantive than others. Some of them we turned into SSIs because we wanted to have that slightly more careful look at things. Others we didn't feel required that. And this SI fixes technical deficiencies. It's not a substantive policy SI that would perhaps need to be thought about in terms of an SSI. And believe me, even the decision making process as to what we would choose to turn into an SSI, was one we had to think about very carefully. Far less a situation where we would have to be putting things into primary legislation, because primary legislation does take considerably longer.
Yeah, which was a concern that the Finance Committee heard. Okay, thank you very much for that.
Thank you, Liz. And can I come to John Scott?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I want to ask you about new powers to legislate, just wondering if the impact on devolved areas. The notification says the SI confers powers returning from the EU Commission, but it's not clear whether any of these are new powers to legislate. So are they new powers to legislate or not?
In a word, no, they're not. There are no new powers to legislate. The existing powers available to the EU Commission have simply been returned to UK, Scottish and Welsh ministers. And I suppose it's how, what are we talking about here in terms of new powers? It's existing powers effectively being returned to Westminster, to Holyrood and to Cardiff. And these legislative powers relate to implementing the principal EU regulations, but not changing the fundamental approach. And of course, for example, the fundamental approach is the reduction target. So none of this affects the target, the reduction target for these gases, but these legislative powers implement the principal EU regulations. So we're adopting what that was. So the powers are for making discretionary implementing regulations for limited specific technical aspects. So they were powers that kind of were already there. The EU Commission hasn't ever, as far as we can see, actually exercised these legislative powers themselves. And we don't see any policy need for them to be exercised by Westminster, Holyrood or Cardiff either. But in the future, if changes in the fundamental approach, the international requirements by the UN Montreal Protocol, if they were required, then alternative primary powers, and this goes back to the issue that Elizabeth Smith was asking, alternative primary powers would be needed to legislate, because that would be the kind of very substantive issue that this regime doesn't cover. This covers limited, specific technical stuff.
Understood. Right, thanks so much. I have a further question from you for you on powers following from the previous notification, and the notification says that the proposed SI confers powers returning from the EU to Scottish ministers within their devolved competence and regulatory functions to the appropriate regulator in Scotland. So are the returning powers being conferred only onto Scottish ministers or also onto the Secretary of State? Because there's a bit of a question mark around that, since they both seem to have powers, and what are the protocols going to be and how is that going to work?
Well, as I've just said, they're pretty limited in their scope, because they're not actually changing the fundamental policy point, which is the reduction target. These are really only for implementing limited aspects. They're unlikely to be exercised by anybody, by any minister in any of the three administrations that I've been referring to. They are concurrent powers, so they're conferred on Scottish ministers concurrently on the Secretary of State, but the Secretary of State can only exercise them with the consent of Scottish ministers, and this can be withdrawn at any time. And this concurrent powers does allow some flexibility for an approach across the three administrations. So they are concurrent powers, and we consider them highly unlikely to be exercised. These are powers that the EU's never bothered to exercise. Highly unlikely that we will. But the Secretary of State can only exercise them with the consent of Scottish ministers.
Right. So the powers being returned to Scottish ministers, which you can, as it were, give to the Secretary of State to exercise, but they're at your discretion. Right. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you, John. And now to Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, convener. I want to just look at the interplay of some of the things that are going on here, because clearly the climate change bill and secondary legislation under that describes gases that form part of our climate change targets. And I don't think that's touched by what we're talking about here, but it does provide the regime we're talking about powers for regulations on goods. Now, given that Scotland aims to be net zero 5 years ahead of the UK, I can foresee that the rules about goods using, in particular, F-gases in refrigerators and so on and so forth, might be different north and south of the border. So how does this interact with the internal market bill, which means if we're trying to get the F gases under control a bit faster than would be the case down south, and given we've got more ambitious climate change targets, that would seem to be a possibility. How does the whole thing interact with the internal market bill? Does it cut across the powers that we might be able to exercise here, notwithstanding that you're telling us you think they probably won't be?
Well, it is for UK ministers to explain the purpose and the application of the UK Internal Market Bill. And obviously, our position on that bill in particular is very clear. But the legislative powers in this retained EU law are limited to implementing specific technical aspects, but not changing the fundamental approach. And the fundamental approach is the target, and that is something that comes out of the UN Montreal Protocol. That's not an EU thing. So that's a protocol that effectively has been accepted, and I cannot I find it difficult to envisage any point at which the UK will want to depart from that protocol. So, and that would take primary legislation, a decision to try and and depart from that. So it is a difficult one. I mean, as I said, our view on the internal market bill and the complications and uncertainties that arise as a result of it, our view is quite clear. But on the issue of this very particular SI, if the UK government was seriously thinking about departing from an international protocol that it is, effectively signed up to, then I think there are potentially far bigger issues in the UN than the internal market bill here. There are huge issues. In theory, I suppose one could say that 5-year gap between our net zero targets does create some issues, and these are issues that we are very alive to and content to explore at the moment with our counterparts. And there is now going to be a regular series of meetings between the four administrations in respect of the drive to net zero, at which I am going to be incredibly boring by reminding absolutely everybody that we have the earliest net zero target. But that does create some issues across the whole of the UK. But given the whole of the UK needs us to get to net zero by 2045, if it's going to get to net zero by 2050, it's a dance that we're both locked into. But these are issues that that we are conscious of. I think it is highly unlikely that they will arise very specifically in the context of this SI, because this SI is so limited in its nature.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think I'm quite satisfied by what you've said in relation to the SI that's before us, but it's perfectly clear that the potential for the internal market bill to have an impact on this at some future point in other legislation remains. So that may be for this committee or its successors. So on that basis, Convener, I'll draw my questioning to a conclusion.
Thank you, Stuart. And can I come to Claudia Beamish?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to your officials. Could I turn our minds to data collection? And are you able to provide any update on the progress to date in data collection and access to EU information in relation to the issues in the SI, please?
Well, the data that was collected previously in, I think, early 18, if I'm correct, for the no-deal scenario is being updated to include subsequent 2018 and 2019 data, because that's, that original data is now a little outdated. And we also require to remove the Northern Ireland portion of that data, because the Northern Ireland protocol means that it remains in the EU regime. So the data has to be overhauled, it's got to be updated, and it's got to be fixed in terms of Northern Ireland. The data from GB, and I'll use GB to cover the three administrations, is used, the data from GB companies is used to establish their F-gas quota allocations, and it's using the EU method, and it is near complete. It will ensure allocations are available for the regime becoming operational in January 2021. And we will continue to have access to historic data for compliance and enforcement purposes. So we are currently in the process, or, you know, and by we, again, that's across the whole of the three administrations. We're in the process of getting that data into shape so that we can use it effectively for a January 2021 start.
I see. Thank you. That's helpful. And I understand, if I'm right, that we are dependent, we will continue to be dependent on the EU Commission for disaggregated data for businesses. Is that the case, Cabinet Secretary? And will we do we have any reassurance on that at all, if I've got that right?
I'm not immediately kind of aware of that. I mean, I'm wondering if Alice, the official who deals with the kind of slightly more technical side of things here, is able to give you a straightforward answer to that. Alice, are you?
Yeah. Alice?
No, the data collection that's been undertaken at the moment will actually disaggregate the data for us in place of using EU data.
Oh, excellent. Great. Okay, thank you very much. And just finally, I think, Cabinet Secretary, is there yet clarity on the UK F-gas phase-out trajectory and what annual quota on what annual quotas are available to business needs will be for the future for the UK market in order to reach the same target as the EU regime by 2030? That's rather I can imagine I wouldn't want to answer that question, but it's kind of need on the record as to if there's work being done on that.
Yeah, okay. I mean, our F-gas target for GB is the same as under the EU regime, so there isn't going to be a change there. That's a 79% reduction by 2030. The division that is envisaged is based on the historical amount GB companies have placed on the market. So it's effectively a situation that they're all in at the moment, and that will continue. The quota allocations, as we spoke about in the earlier question, will be in place for January 21, and thus far have been no concerns raised at all by companies in the data collection exercise. So, we hope that, given that there have been none at this point, with only 2 months to go, that there aren't going to be any issues. But everything is effectively going to continue in January 21 as it has been, and there shouldn't be too much of a difficulty there. But I always want to caveat that kind of statement by saying thus far and as far as we know, because as we have already learnt this year, one can never be 100% certain what's around the corner. But there's no move away from the target. There's no move away from the format of the quota allocation. The companies that are already putting involved in this market are well acquainted with how to manage it. There isn't going to be any change from their perspective, and thus far we are not seeing there being any difficulty envisaged.
Right, thank you, Matt. That's very reassuring. I mean, I happened to read, just for the record, in the FT recently that some Jerry Rowland, who there was an obituary for him, and as some may know, but I didn't, he had been the first scientist to discover holes in the ozone layer, and that was in the 1970s. And this is a real success story in terms of protecting our planet in a positive way. So it's very reassuring to know that in the difficult handover from the EU, that these issues are it appears addressed well.
It is. It is the case that those of us of a certain age do remember very, very clearly what a crisis there did seem to be developing at the time with the ozone layer. And it is remarkable how that has been turned around. And this is the kind of thing that the fact that we can almost say that it isn't particularly controversial now is astonishing where we were decades ago. But, you know, it's a huge success story, and Claudia is quite right to refer to that and to show off her continued reading of the Financial Times.
Thank you. Can I come back to John Scott, who has another couple of questions? John.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'm afraid my questions are a little more prosaic, but I want to ask you about the delegation between regulators and clear up in the first instance something that I can't understand, and I believe my colleagues can't either. Where in the notification it says the 2019 SI also assigns administrative functions to the appropriate regulator, but with to delegate amongst them. Now, I assume that's a typo, but I would just, could you clear that up? Well, that should mean the ability to delegate amongst them, but it has, it's very much in our notes and apparently has come from elsewhere, not from our committee at least. So can you just clear that up, what that means?
I will do my very best to try, and we'll see how far we get. So this statutory instrument is conferring functions, as we've already discussed, it's conferring functions that were previously exercised by the EU Commission on all regulators equally. So it's conferring functions equally on all the regulators. So that is SEPA in Scotland, the Environment Agency in England, and Natural Resources in Wales. Not the Northern Ireland Environment Agency, because as we've already discussed, that is covered by the Northern Ireland Protocol. So the SI is providing powers for ministers to direct that certain functions are exercised administratively by the Environment Agency. There is only one F gas quota holder in Scotland, and I will consider directing the Environment Agency to exercise certain administrative functions on behalf of SEPA. And remember, we've talked about this SI really being about those sorts of technical aspects, not the bigger policy direction. And because there is only the one FGAS holder, I will think about directing the EA to exercise certain administrative functions. That would be things like data collection from the FGAS importer to determine their quota allocation, operating the GB-wide F-gas registry for managing the quota. SEPA, however, will continue to continue with its existing compliance and enforcement role on users of F-gas, and Scottish ministers will have the ability to revoke the direction if alternative arrangements are put in place for SEPA to administer the functions. But I go back to what I was saying, there is only one F-gas quota holder in Scotland. I don't know if that makes it any clearer how this is going to work in practice.
I think it does. My second question was going to be as to how functions are delegated between different regulators, but I suppose for us in Scotland it's self-evident that it would have to be SEPA, really.
Yes, SEPA is our regulator. We need to have a think about it, but it does look as if delegating an administrative function to the Environment Agency is not an unreasonable thing to consider in view of the situation in Scotland. But that direction can be revoked at any time.
It may or may not establish a precedent, may or may not, I say carefully, but it allows flexibility also within, between different regulators, as it were.
Well, yes. And I mean, let's remember that all of the regulators do work together in any case on a number of different issues, not just within the United Kingdom, but across across the world. I mean, environment agencies, whatever they're called around the world, do tend to work together and share information. This is effectively simply just about an administrative function. It's not about any policy, and it's not about compliance and enforcement either. So the, you know, if there was any particular serious issue that arose in respect of the situation in Scotland, it would continue to be SEPA. We would not be asking the Environment Agency to presume that role. It's effectively just, you know, keeping the register, making sure everything's up to date and all the rest of it. That's the kind of thing we're talking about.
Fine, thank you very much.
Thank you. And a final line of questioning from Liz Smith.
Yeah, there's just really one question, and it's a technical question. I think it picks up, Cabinet Secretary, on an answer you gave to Claudia Beamish with regard to the so-called no deal instrument that was laid way back in December 2018, and about which I think you wrote to the committee in early 2019. And then that was replaced with another instrument, and then that was replaced again. Could I just be quite clear that what we are being faced with just now with this statute instrument is on the same principle and is consistent with what was originally laid?
Yes, the No Deal SI is the instrument that contains the provisions originally notified to the Scottish Parliament in 2018. That was originally laid, but there were some substantive drafting errors. I dare say not at the time one of DEFRA's finest hours, but these things do happen in the best regulated of parliaments. So there were some substantive drafting errors. That was withdrawn, corrected, relayed in 2019. But the policy approach is not what changed. So the original notification was still correct. The problem is that we're all now trying to kind of cast our minds back years. And as you know, Liz, that means that personnel on committees and historic memory on committees is changing as well. So, yes.
Thank you for
so,
that clarification anyway. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much to the Cabinet Secretary and our officials today for answering all our questions around this issue, the issues that we did have surrounding this SI. Our next meeting on the 3rd of November will consider draft reports on the Committee's Green Recovery Inquiry and the draft 2021-22 budget scrutiny, and will also consider further EU exit instruments. So that concludes our meeting in public today. Thank you.